Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
And welcome to worship. I'm so excited to see everyone here as we continue in this journey in the Advent season. This is now the second of Advent. We will be lighting two of the candles of our Advent wreath as we get closer and closer to that celebration of the birth of our Lord on Christmas Day. There is so much going on in the church right now. There are so many celebrations. Tomorrow night, we will be having our Advent family night. This is 5 to 7 p.m., where our families, our young people, our children are invited to come, and there'll be crafts, there'll be games, there'll be songs, there'll be a movie. It'll be great. And I'm really excited to get together and have just to get together with our young people and to celebrate this Advent season. And also as a way to give and to give back to the youth and the children of this community. Today, as we will be having a door offering, as we exit the church at the end of worship, to help children and families that are in need during this Advent season, so they can have a blessed Christmas. It's also very much a reminder of all the blessings that we have and ways to give back to those who are around us, those who are less fortunate. To let you know that we are continuing with our Advent Wednesday worship services. They are at 6:30 p.m. every Wednesday, and they are a time for meditation and what is ordinarily can be a very stressful time for people as we get ready for Christmas and all of those preparations. That Wednesday night is a time to calm ourselves and to meditate on what this season truly means. It's at 6:30. We're also having a brief worship service before Neighborhood Center every Wednesday as well, before they share a meal together. So we have so much going on right now as we gather together to worship the Lord in so many different ways. During this season, as we get into the cold and flu season, during this time, that whether it, when it's the passing of the peace, and also with shaking hands at the end, to not shake hands during that time, just to promote healthfulness among us. And this is a time of sharing. But any kind of germs or bugs, those are not the things that we want to be sharing. Before we celebrate, we have celebrated our birthdays and anniversaries. Do we have any other announcements? Do we have any birthdays to celebrate for today? Oh, Tom, you got a birthday coming up. All right. Well, happy birthday. And I'm glad you're with us here tonight. And do we have any anniversaries that we are celebrating? Well, then let us lift up our voices in song and sing happy birthday just for you. And again, it is a humble joy to be worshiping with you tonight. I invite you now to pause, to gather your thoughts, and we will begin our worship. We begin our worship now with our confession and forgiveness. And I invite you to stand as you are able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I invite you now to take a moment of silence and of self-examination. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you now to be seated as we sing together On the Jordan's Baptist Cry. I invite you now to stand as you are able for the blessing and lighting of the Advent wreath. We praise you, O God, for this circle of light that marks our days of preparation for Christ's Advent. As we light the candles of this wreath, kindle within us the fire of your Spirit, that we may be light shining in the darkness. Enlighten us with your grace, that we may welcome others as you have welcomed us. Grant this through Christ our Lord, whose coming is certain and whose day draws near. Amen. We now continue with the first two candles of the Advent wreath. And now let us pray. Stir up our hearts, Lord God, to prepare the way of your only Son. By his coming, nurture our growth as people of repentance and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the hearing of God's word.
Our reading is from Revelation chapter 21. John's vision shows us that in the resurrection, the new age has dawned. God dwells with us already. Yet we wait for the time when the tears that cloud our vision will be wiped away. Then we will see the new heaven, new earth, and new Jerusalem. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The words of the Lord.
I now invite you to stand as you are able as we celebrate together the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the third chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Just before Jesus begins his public ministry, John the Baptist appears, calling people to mend their ways and speaking of a powerful one who is to come. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight.'" Now John wore clothing of camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now, the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water of repentance. But one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite you all to be seated. In grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So it happened again. I was at a gathering with a group of pastors, and parishioners from other churches. It was right after we had our Thanksgiving Eve worship services at St. Andrew's. And I was sitting at a table, and I was talking to some people who I didn't know from another church, and they mentioned that they were from Peace. And I told them how excited I was that Peace just called. They just called a new pastor, Pastor Maggie. And I've talked to her, and she seems really cool, the kind of person that really we could build some bridges between these two churches. You know, work together a little bit. Nothing complicated. We're not a merger or anything like that. Let's play together. We're two churches that are so close. And the people I was talking to then proceeded to tell me something I've heard so many times before. They started to talk about Pastor Cook and about how just this rift that has gone on between these two churches for, I would say, around 100 years, ever since First English broke away from Peace to be an English-speaking congregation. And there has been a rift between the two ever since. And what the rift is changes all the time. And the one that I hear very often that they've talked about Pastor Cook. And for those who don't know him, he was one of he really built this place. And she talked about how once upon a time, when a new family would come to town, it became a race between all of the Lutheran ministers who could get to that family first. And who could get to them first to knock on their door and invite them to worship. Knock, knock, Cook is what she called him. And I'd never heard that one before. Knock, knock, Cook. Because apparently he would get to these churches, they would get there first to invite them to worship. And how just so interesting how this had stayed with people for so long. But what I loved about hearing about this is I love how this was, at the time, this was the kind of ministry and evangelism that churches were doing. The fact that these pastors, they were out there. They were out there and they were knocking on doors. They were racing. There was a rivalry on who could get to a door first. And I always think, like, whoa, now that is evangelism. That is evangelism, just getting out there. And she would say, yeah, knock, knock, Cook as a way of, you know, maybe a way to kind of, you know, maybe make a little bit of fun. Because we were having some fun, too, as we were talking about this. But to realize that, like, nobody does that anymore. And I know we live in a different world. And I know that when a beaming stranger knocks on my door, I'm not as welcoming. It's just what the life is like now. It was different. It was different then when Pastor Cook was doing this. And yet, it was that confidence. It was that being able, I'm going to be able to go out and to reach out directly. Forget any of the other ways that people reach out, all things through, it's through the through the internets and the Googles and all those things. You know, this was hands-on. This was the stuff. And I always loved that about Pastor Cook, because that is what brought my family to this church. That, yeah, the story was that he got to my grandparents' house first. And they came here. They loved it. They stayed. Now, I bring up all of this because we're talking about John the Baptist today. And John the Baptist, when it comes to evangelism, when it comes to reaching out to people and spreading the word of God, he's my hero. He is the model of which I wish to live my life just to reach out and bring people to the Lord. So actually, I'm going to do a walk and talk for a second. That John the Baptist, when you read about him, he was the kind of guy, you could just tell, he had one of those big, big personalities. And yet, when you heard about him, he may not be the kind of guy you would invite to dinner. If he were to show up to our church at any given moment, and the way that he's described in our scripture, someone might call the police. He had that I was being hyperbolic there. Or maybe not, that he had that big personality. They say he wore clothing of camel's hair, and he ate locusts and wild honey. Now, for today, I thought my own celebration of John the Baptist, I did wear camel's hair, the camel hair jacket. His camel hair was probably a little less tailored. And yes, locusts and wild honey. Now, I was very happy to, this is not wild honey, but I did have pure honey in my office, which made me very, I was actually thinking as part of this, just like eat the honey during the sermon, but it's too sticky. But that was his way. I mean, he was this explosive personality, very fearless in how he preached the word. And people, I think they sensed that an authenticity about him. I mean, and he had a lot of disciples. He had a lot of disciples. He had a lot of followers. He truly, truly prepared the way. And he would preach. People would come to the Jordan. They would come to the Jordan River to receive this baptism for the forgiveness of sins. They'd go down. They would be washed clean. They would confess their sins. And even the Pharisees and the Sadducees, you know, they got wind of this. You know, as it says, you know, they wanted, it's like, oh, but, hey, let's check it. Maybe we check out that baptism thing too. You know, maybe hedge their bets, maybe. And that's where, you know, John, fearless as he was like, you brood of vipers. You are coming down here to receive this. The axe is already at the foot of the tree. And he's referring to them. He's referring to these religious people who were businessmen and politicians as much as they were religious leaders. And he was calling them out. He was calling them out on the wanting to receive baptism, and to say that if you want to receive baptism, you have to confess your sins and believe first. And I can tell that is not what's on your hearts. You're just coming down to see what everybody else is doing. But the Lord has bigger plans. The Lord has bigger plans for all of us. And John makes it clear that he is just the opening act. He baptizes with water, but soon one will come who he isn't even worthy to carry their sandals, and that one will baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And that, of course, is Jesus Christ. These words, I mean, these are positively apocalyptic coming from John. The Holy Spirit and fire. These are words that lead all the way to what we heard from in Revelation for today. That moment in Revelation 21, when heaven and earth are coming together, our Lord will wipe away all of our tears. And through this Alpha and Omega, all things in life will truly make sense. And even when I imagine heaven and earth are coming together, I mean, this is heaven and earth, and heaven is now smashing all of our imperfections, smashing all of our sin. so we can live in that new Jerusalem where all life is brought together in the grace and glory of Jesus Christ. And right there, that is where John the Baptist is offering, like right in the waters of baptism, that moment to be invited in, to be invited into that moment of revelation, because that's what this water is. It's an invitation, it's preparation, it's getting ready for the gospel, it's getting ready for our Christ to save us and to fulfill us. These waters, Jesus shows up in these waters. These are the waters of salvation. And they truly save us. I mean, they wash. They wash us clean. Though if I don't return this towel to the kitchen, I'm going to be in real trouble. But not just clean physically. They wash us clean of every sin, and they redeem us for all time. And that is what John is preparing everyone for. I mean, it's something just to get so excited about. And I've got to say that John, he is my inspiration as a minister. Someone who is not afraid to just to go out there and to preach the gospel. Sometimes confront those who are feeling a little too comfortable and let them know that there is something so much more important that's going on here, a gospel that will save our lives. You know, Pastor Cook was doing that. I think it's why he was here for so long. And it's why he built up this church. And I found out something about that story, about how he came into my grandparents' house and he, you know, knocked on the door and they invited him to worship. And something that makes me happy, because it shows me not just how Pastor Cook was special, but how First English was special, is because my family was new to the area and they had already, they were church shopping, as every family would do. And they had already visited Grace, and they had already visited Peace, and they were just kind of deciding which one they wanted to go to. And then Pastor Cook showed up, and that's when they knew where they had to be. You know, with my grandmother singing in the choir, with my grandfather sleeping every Sunday right back there. Very comfortable for him. And, you know, just to remember that this is what we can still do. I mean, that was 1951. This picture that we have up there, that is 1951. There is no reason why we cannot continue to build the kingdom in the same way, or continue to build the kingdom today, in the same way as Knock Knock Cook, or as John the Baptist, all of us, you know, you and I, we prepare the way. So may the peace that surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and your minds with Jesus, the Christ of God. Amen. I now invite you to stand as you are able. As we profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray for the world that cries out to you for hope. God, you renew the church in every age. Inspire church communities and their leaders to set aside their differences for the sake of the gospel. God of grace, hear our prayer. You give us a wisdom of your creation in balance and in harmony. Teach us to be stewards of the earth and companions to its creatures. Restore to wholeness what human greed has harmed. God of grace, hear our prayer. Deliver those in need from suffering and fear. Come to the aid of all who are exploited or abused, especially victims of domestic abuse. Provide safety and shelter for those fleeing from violence. God of grace, hear our prayer. You guide us to protect the rights of those who cannot protect themselves. Protect our protectors, O Lord, and bring safety to our firefighters, police, and first responders. Keep our soldiers safe and strong and sustain those who are far from home. God of grace, hear our prayer. You urge your people to welcome one another as you have welcomed us. We pray for all people who are homebound, hospitalized, or isolated. We pray for all who are sick or suffering. We pray especially for Linda Stuber, Pastor Marty and Lola Ruge, Brittany Ratchman, Jody Porter, David Melke, Deb Jefferson, Roger Suda, Shelby Lloyd, Sue Wellenstein, and Wanda White. God of grace, hear our prayer. You embrace all who have died. Trusting in your promises, we give thanks for their faithful witness. Sustain us in hope until we are united with them in the joy of your eternal presence. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all people in your world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Also with you. Reach out to one another and share the peace of Christ. I invite you to stand once more as we lift up our offertory prayer. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ gathered with his disciples and he took bread. He blessed it and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. Gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Drink of it always, so that you may remember me." And now, let us pray together in the words that Jesus taught us in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Is ready. I invite you to be seated. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace. Amen. Amen. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those you have fed with this one heavenly food through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Receive tonight's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and always give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We conclude our worship now as we sing together, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Thanks be to God. We will. Have a great week.